Welcome everyone, my name is Nathan and this is a brand new series on my channel. This time we're not gonna be inside the game, we're gonna be outside it, developing and programming it. So this series is gonna be half a tutorial, half a progression series of us making a game together. For this purpose, I chose GameMaker as our main software to use. In my opinion, this is the perfect application in order to get into game concept establishing. It's an easy program, it's not overwhelming, so perfect for our purposes. Now this is a project I'm doing in my free time anyways, and I thought why not record it and also get the good ideas of you guys together and implement them in the game. Now my dream was always to make a survival game, which is kind of a combination between Minecraft, Life is Feudal, Factorio, Civilization, and so on and so forth. It should include a hell lot of features and it should be complicated. You should be able to build contraptions that are just crazy. It will be a top-down survival building game. So we're not gonna steer a character, we're gonna kind of control a nation, a small nation. So in today's episode, we're gonna create a limited world automatically. That's the goal. So let's get right to it. So here we are in a brand new project of GameMaker. I call it Project YouTube. Now it is not my intention to go over every detail, over every basic function in GameMaker. I presume that you know about the basics and that you have watched different tutorials which cover the most basic features. Now the first thing we want to create is a room. A room of course is necessary in order to have a world, to have a scenery where you can place game objects, where you can make them come alive and where the user will interact. Without a room, nothing goes. So let's create one. Here we are in the room we've just created. Of course we want to give it a proper name and also settings. So let's switch to the settings tab and we are gonna rename this to RM for room, and we're just gonna call this world. Now I like to add prefixes in order to recognize which category this object is from. So this is a room object, therefore RM as a prefix. For now we want to set the width and height of the room. Eventually we want this to be decided by the user rather than the room itself. But just to get us started, we're gonna start with a room size of 3200 by 3200 and you will see why in just a second. We're also gonna set the room speed to about 50 frames per second. That's an easy number to calculate and it's more than enough for our purposes. This doesn't mean the game will run in 50 FPS, it just means there will be 50 steps for 1 second. So essentially I can run a script 50 times in 1 second. So if we zoom out here a little bit, we can see the size of our room. This is gonna be our world. Another thing I want to change is the snap feature. We are gonna have 64 by 64 pixel tiles. This is gonna be the tile size. 32 by 32 is nice as well, but I like 64 better because you can go more in detail with your art style with 64 pixels. Also, if we divide the width and the height of the room by 64, we will get 50 tiles. And this is why the room width is exactly this. Now, if we started up the game just like this, we would get a window which is 3200 by 3200 pixels. Of course, that's something we don't necessarily want, so let's change the views. We're gonna switch to the Views tab and we're gonna activate view number 0. We have to enable the use of views, of course, and visible when room starts. And you can already see a window popping up here, so right now the game would be this size. Now, I want to change this in a more common format for my purposes, which is 1280 by 720. This is gonna be the view in the room. You can see that the window actually changed. Another thing we also have to adapt is the port on screen. View in room is the view that is visible on the screen and the port on the screen needs to match these numbers, otherwise your pictures are gonna be distorted. Later on we will also be needing this object following function, but for right now we shall be fine. So now that we have adjusted the settings and the views, we can close this window off and save the options. Now, of course, if we tested the game right now, we would get the proper window just as we set it to be, but the scene is plain empty. We will have to populate it with objects. The way we're gonna do this is, of course, not manually. We are gonna place them all in automatically using scripts. But first of all, we have to create textures and objects which correspond with each other. So up here in the corner, we have two categories, one called sprites and another one called objects. We're gonna create a few tile textures and connect them to the object so that we can place them in the scenery. So let's create a new sprite, and I think it's common to have SPR as a prefix for the sprite category. We're gonna call this grass tile set. We're gonna hop over into the edit sprite section, and right here we are able to add a new texture. So let's select new, and we're gonna make this 64 by 64 because that's our tile size. We're gonna double click on this image 0, and we're just gonna give it a green color, just like that. Save, and hit OK. Now later on we will have to deal with a lot more complicated setups for the tile sets. Depending on their placement in the room, we might want to adjust them just to make the world look more realistic and more interesting to look at. But for now we just need a plain grass tile set which we can add to an object. So let's create an object, and we're also gonna call this OBJ grass tile set. So I'm gonna call this the same as the sprite texture but with a different prefix, and we're gonna assign the grass tile set texture to it. For now we don't need to do anything else with that, we are gonna get back to this soon. So let's save it and exit. Another thing that's important to me, I'm gonna create right away because we're gonna make use of it a lot, is a sprite heart. This is the heart of the game. This is kind of my developer's core. We're gonna edit that too. We're gonna create a new one. It doesn't really matter how large it is. Let's just make it 64 by 64, maybe it matters. And we're gonna make a bright small object, maybe something like that. And we're also gonna select it and drag it over to the corner. This way it's kind of an arrow pointing to the 0, 0 coordinates of each tile. So it's kind of a handy visual feature as well. And it's not taking up a lot of space. Eventually we're gonna make it invisible anyways. So let's save that. Of course we're also gonna need to actually add this to an object, otherwise it cannot exist in the room except you draw it. But that's an entirely different chapter. So let's call this object heart as well. We're gonna select the right texture, and we're gonna change the depth for this one. The more minus something gets, the higher up it is. So if we set this to minus 100, we'll make sure that it is always on the top of everything. The last thing we want to do is to go into the room and actually add this developer's heart. With the objects category, we can just click on this and choose heart, can place it in the first tile. This is where I want it to be when the room spawns. This is the only object in the room and will be responsible for all other objects to appear. So now that we have our room and our object heart placed safely in there, it's time to add scripts to this object. Let's double click it, and right here in the properties we can add events and actions. Actions cannot occur without an event, so the event is basically the cause for the actions and decides how often and when the actions will execute. For the tile generation, we want to add an event which is called step. This event will be executed each frame, just gonna take a normal step. In our case, each frame means 50 frames per second, if you remember. Now, whatever we put in here will be executed 50 times per second. We can switch to the control tab right here and either add a script like this, and you can do some programming, but we're not gonna do that. We're gonna get rid of that again. What we're gonna do is add a script over here. The reason I'm doing this is because I will have to access those scripts I'm writing right now a lot, and it's easier for me to have them in this list so that I can access them with a double click rather than accessing the object, going to the right event, and then double clicking the script. We're gonna call this script tile generation, and for now I'm just gonna save it like this, and we need to make sure to add it using this button right here. A window pops up, and right here from the drop down list we can choose our new script. I'm also gonna add another event to the heart, which is a create event. This event will only occur once when the instance is being generated. Now, since we have this in our room, it will be considered as generated once, so whatever I have right here in this action section will be only executed once. I also want to create a script for that. This script is gonna be called global variables. In here, I'm gonna store every variable the game needs access to from various locations. So let's make sure we are adding this to the create event. And since we have both scripts in there, we can close this off. We don't have to access it anymore for the time being. We can just double click these files and the script will open up and apply to the object whenever we save it. Okay guys, it's time to actually write our few first lines of code. First up, I want to give this a proper title. For that, I'm gonna make 3 slashes. This will make sure that you can actually see the title from outside the script as a file name. I'm gonna call this tile generation. So what do we want to achieve with this script? Testing the game right now, we can see that we have this body right here on the first tile. What I want to achieve is that it places down an instance of the grass tile set right here, then it will go over to the next tile, place one again, and so on and so forth. Once it is done with this row, it will switch to the next row and place more tiles, and so on and so forth, until it has reached the lower edge of the room, which by the way isn't this window size. The room of course is much larger, we don't see the entire room at the moment, but nevertheless that's the idea. So remember, this script is on the step event, so we can actually use the steps in order to make this progress work. So what I said is that we want to place an instance, and this is the command in order to do so. Now down at the bottom you can actually see what we need. We have the command right here. It requires an X position, a Y position, and an object. Now the coordinates where we want to create the instance are really easy. We want to create it at the exact same spot as we have our heart, which is X and Y. X and Y are variables which will always adapt to their object's position. So also, if we have our marker on the second tile, the second grass tile will be created right here rather than on the same spot. So we cannot use numbers, but we have to use variables. Next up, we are gonna choose the object, which is gonna be the grass tile set. Now, after this instance create, we want to make sure that the X position of our heart goes up by 64. Now, since we're gonna use 64 a lot, and this number is subject to change, we are gonna choose a global variable for this. This is gonna be global tile size. If you remember from before, we had a global variable script. This script being only executed once and at the beginning of our room creation is the perfect script in order to initiate all the variables. And title this global variables as well. Now the first variable we are gonna initiate is the tile size, which as I said is 64 at the moment. We can save this, and only this gives us access to this variable. Otherwise, the program would have given us an error because it tries to read from a variable which doesn't exist, but now we made sure it does. Now, I know we're going slow right here at the beginning, but that will change eventually. I'm just gonna explain each function once. You just saw it briefly. It was actually generating the tiles just as we anticipated, but of course it will just go endlessly and not go to the second row. We will have to program that in as well. So let's do that. We say if the X position equals the room width, which is another variable which always changes with its object, and the object of that is of course the room, we're gonna use a variable and not the actual room size of 3200 because this is also subject to change, and eventually I want the user to decide how large the world needs to be for his purposes. If our X coordinate equals the room width, we want to change X to 0 again, and we also want to add to the Y coordinates. We want to go to the next tile. If you don't know, right here is 0, 0, and the further to the right you go, the higher up the X and the further down you go, the higher up the Y. So essentially what we made sure is that once we reach the end of the room, X will be 0 again, and we also add one tile to the Y coordinate, so it will be on the second row. So if we have a look at the results of that, we should be seeing all the tiles generating just like that, and this is beautiful, this process. Now of course this will also go endlessly, and that's something you definitely want to avoid. You don't want to create instances forever, otherwise it will slow down your game eventually. So we need to make sure there is a stopper function. So let's say if the Y coordinate reaches the room height, then we want X to be 0 and we want Y to be 0, and now we need a way to kind of deactivate the tile generation. So we're gonna create a new variable, a global one, called global tile generation equals false. Now of course we first have to initiate this global variable, which we do right here, global tile generation equals true. So at the beginning when we start the room, the tile generation will be true, and once all the tiles have been placed, the marker should go to 0 again and deactivate the tile generation. Now of course we need to grab all of this, and we need to make sure that it is within an if statement, which is if global tile generation equals true. So only if the global tile generation equals true, the tiles will be generated. Otherwise, the marker will go back to 0, 0 and everything will stop. Now, of course, we want to test this out, so let's do it right away. And there will be another problem immediately popping up. Of course, we cannot really see everything. We want to be able to see everything from the room, and also it goes a little bit slow. We're gonna change that right away. So let's open up the world, and we are gonna change in the settings the speed to 500 instead. It means we are generating 500 tiles per second instead of just 50. But also, once the tile generation is done, we want to make sure that we go back to the normal room speed, so we're gonna change that to 50 again. Another thing I wanted to do to see the whole room and observe the generation is a new command called view. Oh man, that's hard to say. And it's gonna be view 0. If you remember, in the room we have view 0 activated. This is our main view right here, which only covers a portion of the screen, and we want to change that to the room width for the time being, so that we can see the whole thing. Of course it will be distorted a little bit, and of course we also want to do this for the height, which is h view equals room height. And this will basically allow us to see everything in the room in our 720p window. And you can already see that it generates the tiles much faster. And if you have a closer look up here, our marker has gone back to the 0, 0 coordinate and it doesn't continue anymore. Now this also means that once the tile generation is done, we might want to change back to the normal view, which can happen right here for instance. And we want to create new global variables, I believe. This is gonna be global room width and global room height. Room width. Now of course I made a thinking mistake. I want this to be the view width and not the room width. View width, which is 1280, global view height also equals 720. Okay, so now if we test it, we have the large view of the whole room, which is distorted a little bit, and now we get back to 720p. You can see it because the marker is a little bit larger. Great, so everything seems to be working so far. Now since we are the developer of this game, we of course want to have a little bit of a control what's happening on the board. Not everything is visible with the eyes. For instance, if tiles get created outside the room, or if they get created double and so on and so forth, that's all stuff we need to test. Optimization from the start. For our code, that means I want to generate a variable which I'm gonna call global.tileCount, and we're gonna add 1 to that. So whenever we create a tile, the tile count will go up 1. Of course we're gonna have to add this to our global variables as well. TileCount is gonna equal 0 at the start. So now that we have this variable, we want to make sure that it gets drawn on the screen so that we know what's happening. For this purpose, I'm gonna go into the properties of the heart. In here, we're gonna create a new event from the drawing section. and it's going to be called draw GUI. This event will make sure that X and Y coordinates are not drawn within your room, but on your screen rather. So relative to your screen, you can draw things with this event. We're gonna add a script right away. For now, I'm not gonna generate a script for this. We're just gonna write it in like that. So that's gonna be the draw dev GUI. And since I made the three slashes, you can now actually see the title on here. That's what I meant before. Now, the dev GUI is a really, really simple thing, at least the way we are doing it. What we want to do is first set a color, and I believe white would actually look rather well on green. So everything after this line will be set to white. We could have another line right here, and here we could set another color, for instance black, and draw something differently. This way you can also draw rectangles and basically everything you want, but we are going to keep it simple for now. It's just as an information for ourselves. So we're gonna draw a text, and right now we have to specify the X and Y coordinates of this text. I think I just want to have it on the top left corner, so we're gonna choose 0, 0. Now we have to define the string. I'm gonna go with a text input first, so we're gonna have some quotation marks, and this is gonna be instances. Now what we're drawing here is plain text. This has nothing to do with any variables. This is just gonna be there permanently, but the next row is actually gonna be the variable. So we're gonna draw another text, and this time we're gonna set the X coordinate to maybe about 100. Later on, if we want to get into detail, we can also get the length of this string and set it to the X coordinate right here, but we're just gonna keep it simple. 100 should be enough so that our variable will not be inside of the instances text, which we already have. The Y coordinate is still gonna be 0, and the string this time is gonna be a variable. Now, I'm not gonna go with a global variable just now. With this text, we want to get all the instances in the room. So we're gonna do an instance count right here. This variable right here basically tracks all the instances in the room, everything in existence. Now, the next thing we want to draw is on 0 for X and about 20 for Y. So this is gonna be beneath the first text. And this is gonna be tiles. And if you remember, we do have a variable called tiles. So we're gonna do the same thing as we did before, but we're gonna make sure that it is beneath the instances. So that's global.tileCount. That's all we needed to do, basically. We are ready to start the game, and what we should be seeing is a number on the top right here. I also changed the tiles slightly so that we can actually see the zooming in effect. So right now we are on 720p again, and up here we have the tiles number, which is 2500, which is perfect because we have 50 by 50 tiles, and we have a total instance count of 2501, which of course is our heart. The one heart. Now, using this information, we will be able to actually add a loading bar and everything. But looking at the time, I don't want to keep these episodes too long because they might be exhausting to follow. There's a lot of information I will be throwing at you. Of course, this first episode was still easy, and we will get into a lot more, like inventory management, GUI management, and so much more. This is going to be a great game, and hopefully you guys will actually contribute with your ideas and also your coding knowledge. And otherwise, maybe you can learn something and create your own games with this awesome program. So that means the next time we will definitely continue with world generation, such as trees, rocks and stuff, resources which we will be able to gather up, we will have to code actions, we will have to add villagers and much more. So stay tuned for the next episode. I hope you enjoyed and have a great time. Bye bye. Whee!